Hello, thank you for watching. I am back with another chatty, relaxed makeup video where I talk about something or a few different things or lots of different things while I do my makeup. It's not a tutorial, it's just chatting while I put stuff on my face. I've already got my little butterfly. These are so cute. These little butterfly clips. I got them in a PR package a while ago. And they're just a little bit more glamorous than using a headband. So I thought today we could talk about my house, or our house, but I'm saying my because it's just me here, that Reese and I are building, or are waiting to have built. My skin seems to be a bit confused at the moment. I think in hindsight, now that it's kind of settled down again, I think it was hormonal, but I was, all of a sudden my skin felt so oily to the point where all of the skincare products I was using I had to like halve, because when I touched my face it felt like just ugh. And then I was getting loads of little red bumps all over, like little just white heads in my pores, like small little tiny bumps, but just enough to be, when there's like a lot of them, to make a difference in my overall appearance. And it was really starting to irritate me, but I'm guessing now that it's settled down, it was just my period, because now that that's gone, it's chilled out a little bit. But I haven't had that before, I don't think. I'm going to use a Fenty, and that's the weird thing as well. I'm using the matte one instead of the hydrating one. I don't know if my skin would prefer me to use the hydrating one at the moment, now that it has settled down a bit, but I'm still feeling like it's on the marginally oilier side. So many of you, if you're watching these chatty videos, will already know about the whole house building thing. I spoke about it in the last video. I think someone asked about the budget of the house or something, and I gave the whole story about that side of purchasing a house. Which brush do I want to use? I think I might. This one's nice and small, but this one covers a larger area. I might use this one. This is the Morphe Y5. Again, it's gonna be a long video. I generally don't do short videos anymore. I'd rather have a long video full of substantial stuff than just rushing over things in a short video. In terms of building versus buying, it wasn't like a conscious thing where we were like, yeah, we're definitely going to build, we want to build. It was kind of a, we've exhausted all of our options, we've thought about buying, and we did this with our first house. We exhausted all the options, we looked at land, we looked at houses, we spoke to builders, we spoke to like the developers of like land developers and all that kind of stuff, and looked at lots and just looked at every possible avenue basically, because I think that's what you should do when you're making like one of the biggest decisions of your life, taking on probably the biggest amount of debt you'll ever have, unless you're paying cash, which is obviously the minority. So we did that this time around as well, and because we weren't living in Perth anymore, it kind of felt like we were starting from scratch, because we had to figure out, first of all, what area do we want to be in? Because at least with Perth, we know all the areas very well, so we knew which one would suit us best. But down here, we were kind of, yeah, starting from scratch a little bit, which is also kind of fun. I feel like those processes are really fun. And I think we just couldn't find any houses that really stood out to us. And I don't think we actually wanted to jump straight into, I think we were planning on renting for a while down here and just like adjusting to it, seeing if Reese would find work down here, seeing how I liked it, and I knew I'd love it, but you never really know until you're actually down here. So kind of just testing the waters a little bit first. The more time passed, we were like, actually, no, I don't think we want to spend too long renting. I think we want to just get straight back into the market. Then we went back into the whole, yeah, buying versus building, and we couldn't really find any houses that we liked that were pre-existing that suited what we wanted. And then we started looking at builds, you know, brand new builds in terms of, like display homes and things like that. And we really kind of gravitated towards that because the idea of starting something from scratch was a lot more exciting. And there are lots of benefits of buying an established house, of course, like there are many, but there are also a few downsides too. Like when we bought our last house, it's the lead up, it's so exciting, and like, you know, you're just thinking about all the furniture you can get and what rooms you're gonna use for what. This shade was a bit more orangey than I had envisioned it was going to be. So then when you move into the house, it's really exciting, and I'd say like for the first couple of weeks that feeling sticks around. And it does kind of, I mean, you know, it depends on what kind of house you're buying, because we bought something that was like just built. It was built basically the year that we bought it, so, and there wasn't much backyard space, there wasn't much we could do there, so it was kind of like you just move in and everything was already done, which some people is exactly what they want. And I think for us it was good at the time, but as we got a little bit older, we were kind of like, it would be nice to have a project, it would be nice to have something to work on the weekends, and nice to have a backyard where you can, you know, grow veggies or plant flowers or trees, or I don't know, it's just, it felt a bit limiting. And especially for Reese, because he loves building things and fixing things and working on things, it was really like, yeah, he couldn't really, there was no room to grow in that sense. So we're thinking that's probably, and same thing, I've spoken about this before, when people want, you know, fancy cars, and I'm number one advocate for fancy cars, I love them, they're a total waste of money, but because they're just a car, you can buy any kind of car and it'll do the job. But there's something nice about, you know, having a one that's really nice on the outside and inside and has special features and blah blah blah. That's why people buy them, right? But I think a lot of the time we build up this image of what it's going to be like, and it's like a drug, it's a really quick hit, and then once you've got it, you get a couple of weeks out of that fresh, amazing, fun, excited feeling, and then it's just your new standard and it becomes something that you're used to. And it's not that you don't come, like you forget how lucky you are to have it, you're not grateful for having it, it's just that, yeah, it becomes your new standard. You're grateful to have it, but it's not until you drive a different car that you realize how nice your car is, because it becomes your standard, you know what I'm saying? So the same thing with the house, it's like, buying an established house is an instant hit of like, yes, I got it. But then it kind of just takes off and it's just another house again. Even though it's a really nice house and it's more comfortable and blah, it's still like that hit is just a really, it doesn't plateau, it's just like And I hope no one misinterprets this as me not being grateful, because I think of all people, I'm one of the most grateful and aware of how, I'm trying not to use the word lucky because I don't believe in, I don't know. Anyway, I'm rambling. So we thought to ourselves, this is the Hourglass Vanish Cream Concealer in, Vanish Concealer in Cream. So we were thinking about that, and I've seen that little TikTok trend where you put concealer there. I haven't actually probably watched that. Apparently it's meant to, do something. Probably said it wrong, but that's fine. Yeah, I think it's meant to be like in here and then there and not on here, but whatever. The young kids can do it that well, just took to my place. So yeah, recently I was thinking like maybe, even though I am, that was way too much, queen of impatience, maybe this is actually what we're looking for. You know, you move down south, and for those of you who aren't in WA or don't know what I mean by down south, it's basically just rural, I hate this word, rural, like more in the country, more a small town, out of the city, just like slower lifestyle. A country town, I guess. It's not like, the place I'm living in isn't like inland country, like farmland everywhere. It's still slightly modernized, but it's still a country town. It's still 3 hours away from the city. So, you know, you come to a place like this generally to slow down and to live a simpler life, which is exactly what appealed to me about it. And so we thought maybe a building would actually be perfect, because the process is drawn out, so the rewards are drawn out. Like right now we're dying inside because it's taking so, I'm trying to manifest this, that it's going really quickly. I keep saying to everyone it's taking so long, so I'm probably just creating that for myself, but it is, yeah, we are building at a time where everyone else is building, because everyone's moving down here and there aren't enough trades to go around at this point, or so we've been told. So it's just, it's our choice to build now, and we're, yeah, it is what it is. We knew what we were getting into and we still chose to go ahead with it, so it's fine. But because this whole process has drawn out so much, it's actually going to be good for us, because it's like the excitement is spread out over different stages. You've got the stage where the block's being cleared, and then you've got the slab, and then you've got the walls and the roof and the finishings and this and that. And the camera just died, so I'm not sure what was included and what wasn't before it died, but essentially that is why we chose
to build.
I really love this Fenty powder. I need to buy another one because it's, I've hit pan and it's one of the few that really mattifies my under eye area. Yeah, so then we decided to build after finding a good builder that had good reviews and a display home that we fell in love with. That's the number one thing I should like recommend if you're thinking about building. Try and find a house design that has a display home that's open because it makes such a difference. Gosh, I don't know what it would be like to build a house not having actually walked inside of it before. Because you get an idea of space and how you can customize it and how they've furnished it, because the display home that we looked at was furnished really well as well, which to their credit, you know, helps you envision yourself there because it's just makes the whole thing look way nicer. And you've also got to be aware that the display homes are normally like the top of the line specs and everything, and they've spent like a lot of money on things that aren't included in the price that you're given for that same house. Like, you know, fancier cupboards or, not cupboards, but, you know, landscaping and external finishes. Like, we thought a certain type of cladding was included, but it wasn't. That was an upgrade that we didn't realize. It didn't cost much extra, but it was still not included, and we thought it was. Just lots of little things like that. You just got to be very aware of that when going into it, I guess. I think the display home we looked at was probably, like, the decking. I think they said the decking in itself was, like, 15 grand or 20 grand just in the decking that they had in that display home. So yeah. Oh, I got Botox the other day in my forehead and I feel, oh, God, it's good. That's as much as like, it's probably still not even fully all the way like active yet, but oh, just my shiny forehead. There's a line we can get where the forehead's too shiny, your whole face is like, but I just got it here. And to slightly raise my eyebrows a tad, but all my little, those lines that I always complain about are now smoothed out. I feel crispy and fresh. What am I gonna set my face with? Should I go all out? I'm gonna get a little old school with it. Good, this is a little bit lighter. Face powder, just to add to the intense coverage. The Australis Flesh and Flesh, yum, Fresh and Flawless Powder in Medium Tan. I don't know if they've increased their shade ranges for these, but they were very limited. I've got my little makeup cover. And the house design we want is like a rural design. So it needs a, you know, a certain kind of block. It needs, in order for it to be, it's a house that maximizes on like windows. So basically every side of the house has windows and like raked high ceilings and the nice windows on the top. So you don't want to be putting that house on a suburban block where you're looking into someone else's straight at someone's like collarbone fence. You want it to be on a block that has space around it. So you're looking at trees or hills or bush or something. And ours will be looking at bush, which is very lovely, very grateful to be. Oh God, I can't wait to have privacy. I should have mentioned this at the start of the video. I might put a little caption in at the start. We do have a little Instagram account called Loz Curtis Home, and that is just going to be documenting the process, and we've done like a few posts already talking about things that I might just talk about in this video as well. The Hourglass Ambient Lighting Bronze in Nude, Ambient Lighting Bronzer. Nude Bronze Light. I feel like I haven't taken a breath this whole time. That brush I just used, if you're interested, I always forget to say, is the Morphe M581. And this is the Morphe E4. I use this for blush and bronzer. It's interchangeable. So a lot of this will probably only be relevant if you're in Australia. I think Australia white. I don't think it is just WA. I don't think it is, because there's bushfires all over Australia. There are bushfires all over Australia. But the number one thing we didn't know about, which was our responsibility to know, but wouldn't have hurt if the real estate agent, who has a lot of experience in the area, could have told us. But BAL ratings, BAL stands for bushfire attack level. And it's a sliding scale. So you've got They're like, let me just find it so I can read it. I don't even know if it's interesting to you guys, but it was interesting to me. And I know that when I spoke about it on the Instagram page, a lot of people messaged and told their stories of their own vowel reading issues, and it's a wonderful thing. Try this Tarte blush. I don't know what it is. Bushfire attack level is a means of measuring the severity of a building's potential exposure to ember attack, radiant heat, and direct flame contact. So you can see it'll focus. Yeah. If you look at that, the one here, that's like a very dangerous situation where there's a high risk of ember attack and your house will basically burn down. But on this one, it's very, very low. So if there was a fire, there's no risk of your house being burned. So at the moment, our block is FZ, which is that one there. But through some specialized clearing and certain regulations and bushfire materials when making the house, I'll explain, that was a terrible way of explaining that. Ours is currently 29, which I'm guessing is there or there. I can't say. I think it's there. I think that's 40.
This is a touch. That's not going to do much to my skin. I think that's a bit dull. Exposed. I said I'd try it, so let's try. If your house... Oh, that's quite... I always judge blushes before I try them. You can never judge a blush by its colour. It always looks different on the skin. That's actually very nice and subtle. I'm exposed. Terrible dad joke. If you were left with a bowel 19, your building, your house build cost could increase by like $5,000. For example, I think that's, or maybe it's 12.5, or is it 19 that's $5,000? And then it jumps exponentially to like 15 or 20, and then I think 40, about 40 is like, geez, I don't know. We didn't get a quote for that because we didn't know how much it would be. It was going to be at 29, I think, so we didn't need to get a quote for the 40. Let's all take a deep breath. I feel like I can't breathe at the moment. So yeah, we had to fork out quite a lot extra to build the house that we wanted to build. And even then, we weren't even able to use some of the materials that we wanted to use because they weren't bushfire rated. And we have to use certain products for our decking and things like that just to comply with the regulations, which is annoying that you have to spend the money and blah, blah, blah. But it's like, if there is a fire, it means that your house has a better chance of staying put, or it minimizes the damage. So, you know, I do feel like all houses should be built according to those regulations. It not sucks. And there's certain things on our block that we have to do, like have a 17 meter wide turning circle or this T-shaped thing for fire. It's very intense what we have to do, and costly, but these are the situations you find yourself in sometimes, and sometimes it's worth spending the money early on so that you, you know, don't have to rebuild your house if there is a fire, because, yeah. I'm gonna do my brows. This is the good old fashioned makeup store premium tri-brow in blonde. We had pre-start, which the last post on my Loz Curtis homepage was talking about how we were waiting to get the pricing back, but we finally got it back, and it's so interesting. The things like shaker cabinets. I'll Google that before I talk about it because most people don't know what they are, and I didn't know what it was. I think Reese was the one that told me shaker cabinet. He was the one that actually introduced me to them. Basically, without border, but that one has a little angle that goes down. You can see it's kind of like a picture frame where this bit here is angled down. Ours is just straight. It's a bit more modern, I think, but it's also more expensive. I didn't realize, again, it's the whole learning process. I thought that was included, and I didn't think it would change. I thought the flat cupboards and the shaker cabinet cupboards would be the same price. Naive, perhaps. But that's just what I thought. And so, and Reese was adamant. He's like, they're not, they're more expensive, they're more expensive. I'm like, oh, I don't know about that. He was correct. And we went into the pre-start, no, the color selections meeting, which was before pre-start, when we chose all of our tiles and colors and all that jazz. She said that the doors, the cupboard doors that we wanted were a lot more expensive than just the plain flat ones. So, and I was like, oh, okay, like, you know, how much? Thinking, surely not too much. And she said an extra like $4,000 or $5,000. Yeah, and I hope there's no one watching this. I'm sharing this in a, as if it's a comfortable, safe space. If there's gonna be someone watching this like, oh my God, you're complaining about expensive doors when there are people out there starving and there's coronavirus and people can't pay their rent. I know me in this, I'm really hoping I don't have to clarify that. I'm hoping we're all mature enough, sensible enough to know that I'm not genuinely angry or genuinely upset or unaware of the other issues that are existing in this universe right now. I'm very well aware, but just because other people are suffering doesn't mean I'm not allowed to have an opinion on something that exists in my world right now. I don't know, hopefully you all know me well enough to know that I'm not the kind of person, but sometimes, anyway. So I know there are lots of you that probably get tired of me justifying, explaining myself, but I feel the need to do it because otherwise the one time that I don't do it is when people will come on and be like, and just attack me for the silliest of things. So it just helps to put a disclaimer in there sometimes, I guess. But anyway, yeah, that was a bit of a shock. I didn't expect that price. And I think it probably stung a little bit more because we both knew that it was something we weren't going to sacrifice. We weren't going to just save the money and put the money somewhere else. So that was one of the most excited, that was one of the things we were most excited about in the house, is having those cabinets. Like it was a kind of a focal point of the house because the kitchen's in the middle of the house and we wanted these brass taps and brass handles and stuff, so that it just had this whole vision, and without those cabinets it just wouldn't have looked the same. So I think it just stung a little bit more knowing that we were never not going to have them, so whatever the price was, we basically just had to pay it. And then we went into our other meeting, or it was that same meeting, I can't remember. I think I made my skin too matte. This isn't sticking very well. There are different types because we're going with it's not even like custom fancy, we're not going with a custom builder, which was even more expensive. I mean, kitchens are just expensive as it is, obviously, but we are going through a project builder and they just use Laminex, so it's just Laminex branded cupboards or whatever you call them. We're having stone bench tops and all that, but just, yeah, the cupboards, the brand is, I'm trying to get comfortable on my seat, but I'm knocking everything. The brand is Laminex. So with the Laminex, it's my understanding that the flat doors are easy to make, and then you just wrap the sheet of color, whatever color you choose, around the door, and that's why it's that price, because it's just easy to do and quick. Then there's the shaker cabinet, which is another level of complexity because of the little border thing. And it also means that the shaker cabinet with the little angle that I just showed you, that one's actually the cheaper of the shaker cabinets because I think it can still be form wrapped, I think it's called, where it's just like wrapped over and cooked in there somehow. And so that was, yeah, but we didn't want that one. We wanted the next one, which is just the straight flat border, doesn't have that angle, and you can't form wrap that, I think, because the angles are too sharp. So it has to be painted, three layer paint or something, which Reese was saying is like the highest quality paint or finishing on a surface or a cabinet. And it was used in like boats or cars or something. It's basically like the most heavy duty, highest quality finishes. And so that was extra on top of the money that we were already paying, which stung a tad, I guess, because we weren't aware of it. The whole upgrades of all, because we had the scullery, the mudroom we've kept flat because it's just a functional room, doesn't really matter. It's kind of going to be a nice like dull greeny olivey color with like just kind of like a bushy kind of color. And then the scullery and the main kitchen are going to have like a light gray cabinet with the dark wood floor and like brass taps and handles. And I think all of the, yeah, all of the, I think it was like 7.5 or something for everything. Does that also include the mudroom? I can't remember, but it was a very significant upgrade. But we do have a lot of cupboards and the kitchen's quite big, so I guess it just makes sense. But yeah, but then in the same breath, we also got quotes for other things that we thought were going to be really expensive. Like, we wanted to change the cornices, but cornices are notoriously expensive to change, so we just kept with the cheapest basic ones, even though we would have liked the other ones that are a bit more, I don't know. But then I think it's just cornice, you're not going to think, see it every day and think, oh, I hate that cornice. And then door frames, we didn't like the standard one. We wanted to upgrade that, which we thought was going to be expensive, but it was like a couple hundred dollars. We added some bulkheads to the kitchen to fill in any spaces where we didn't have cupboards. Thought that was going to be like a grand or two. That was like a couple hundred dollars. So we saved money in places that we thought we would lose money, and we spent money in places we thought we would save money. So it was all kind of relative. And at the end, the pricing, we ended up spending what we thought we would, because some things were more expensive and some things were cheaper, so ended up rounding out anyway, which was fine. And we got basically everything we wanted. Reese wanted nicer toilets, but I was like, you literally poo and pee on them, it does not matter. If you're gonna get fancy toilets, get the ones that are like bidets. Oh, that's a life goal, getting a bidet. One day we'll get a bidet. It is another level of comfort, you know? I've been doing this eyebrow for so long and I don't even like how it looks. I think I powdered my skin too much because I'm not getting crisp lines. It took me like 2 seconds to the other eyebrow because I wasn't talking. I was also just thinking when I was doing it, that I think some people don't like people that are financially maybe more in a more comfortable position than they're in. When those people talk about struggles that aren't like, I can't pay my bills, or I'm struggling with, you know, putting food on the table. I think people don't like hearing people that don't have those struggles complaining about money issues over things that are trivial, like, oh, you know, expensive kitchen cabinets, because it does sound a bit like, I don't know, tone deaf perhaps in this climate. But I think you've also got to remember that there are people that follow me that have exponentially more money than I do, that would complain about things that I would never be able to afford, but I don't sit there and think, oh, lucky for them, they shouldn't be complaining, I can't afford that. It's just like, it's just the way the world works. Some people are in different financial positions, and you know, you've got people like Jeff Bezos who could basically own all of us if he wanted to. That is wrong. I don't think one person should have that amount of accumulated wealth, and that just seems just fundamentally wrong. It just seems dangerous. But if we're talking about like just everyday people that have differing incomes, it's just the nature of the world, and I don't think it makes sense to be angry about that. The same thing if someone has a nice big house, or you know, has a really great job, or a nice car, or I don't know, whatever, or a successful child or something. You shouldn't let that person be angry and jealous and envious and complain that they're like out of touch with the common person. It's just that person's obviously got themselves in a situation where they've been able to achieve something that they have wanted to achieve that maybe you have not wanted to achieve yourself, or haven't been able to yet, or aren't at that stage yet. You know, it's just, I just don't want people to bring negative energy towards, like, I just, it's, yeah, I am being honest with pricing and things like that because I feel like I really appreciate it when people that I follow are upfront with things like that, because it gives me something to compare my experiences to, and kind of gives me, I don't know, I just feel better informed when I know things like figures and financials with things like that. But it does also leave me exposed to people, you know, coming for me and saying that, yeah, all the things that I said before. So I hope I don't get any of that after this video, because I am choosing to be very open with certain parts And if it does backfire, which I don't think it will, I think generally my audience now is very understanding and supportive. But if it does backfire, it just means that I wouldn't do it again. And that's a shame for the people that were respectful, because I just don't have the energy to deal with negative people. So I think now we're just waiting for our building permits. I think they have been lodged. I think we're just waiting on them to be approved. Then we can start like the clearing process, and then the slab can go down. And that's when things really start happening, because right now it's been a lot of like planning. So things are moving and, you know, going forward, but it also doesn't really feel like it because everything is physically, nothing's changed. You're looking for some good eyeshadows. Mecca sent me their whole little single, Mecca Max, their whole single shadow collection when they released them. And I find myself using them very often. They're really great quality. I'm going to do with this shade, which is Totally. I think I use this one probably the most often because we've basically chosen everything now. I haven't chosen carpet, which is ironic because Reese is a carpet layer, but I love the look of wool carpet. It has a certain, it's like thick and round, and I don't like the normal kind of carpet as much. I love the wool carpet, but I don't want to have wool carpet. I don't want to support that industry. I just feel like I googled it. There are some industries I think which might produce ethical, well, I don't know if ethical is the right word, but I don't know. I just have a moral thing with that. I just don't think I could have that carpet in my house and not think about it every time I walked on it, and it smells like wool, smells like sheep. So I think my conscience wouldn't allow me to go through with that. So I probably, yeah, we probably won't, even though it's visually every single carpet that, like carpet sample that Reese brings home is wool, and it's only really those ones that I'm like, yep, yeah, that one's my favorite. What type of carpet is it? And he says, well, and I'm like, nope, damn it. So we're still gonna figure out carpet. That's funny as well, for a carpet layer, you think we have carpet everywhere, but we're having like hard floorboards through pretty much throughout the house, except for, you know, the obvious areas, like, well, the only areas are bedrooms. He was just like, we'll never have carpet in the hallway. People put carpet, like it's really weird in Perth. Everyone puts carpet in their hallways, and it means that the jobs are way harder for him. But down here, no one puts carpet in their hallways, which he loves because the jobs are so much more straightforward, and it makes so much more sense because the hallways are the most like high traffic areas, and carpet just wears and wears so quickly when you have it in a high traffic area. So we're having floorboards there, and we're not planning on having kids, so it's not going to have, you know, little kids running on floorboards and damaging them. We're so conscious of things like that. So carpet's a bit more forgiving in terms of like general day-to-day maintenance. So we're having, what floorboards are we having? It's engineered timber. So it's real timber on top, and then underneath it's like a engineer, it's like a, I don't know, not real timber on the bottom, it's timber, but it's like a blend or something like that. So it feels like real timber, and on top it is real timber. It's not like a fake one, but it's not pure timber. It's a cheaper alternative. It's still more expensive, it's cheaper than having solid wood floors. And then outside we're having composite engineered timber stuff. Basically it's not real timber for the decking outside, because it's lasts better in the sun, and it's also bushfire rated, so it's safer to use, and it complies with bushfire regulations. So a few people asked, you know, are you building with a project builder or a custom builder? And a project builder, if you don't know, is a builder like that builds hundreds of homes that, you know, is it just like a mass home producer? It's like buying your groceries from Coles or Woolies rather than going to a little local supermarket that's run by a family or something. You know what I mean? Like, project builders will probably do hundreds of builds a year, whereas custom builders would do, you know, a handful or 10 or 20 or something, I don't know, but like way less. but probably get a higher chance of being a better quality build because they're not pumping them out, I'm guessing. And you also have more flexibility around what you can do, because we wanted custom, we wanted to supply our own taps and fittings and handles, and we assumed that would be fine, but it wasn't until we actually just double checked and asked, and they had to approve it, and sometimes they don't approve it. And even in, but they did luckily, and even in our main bathroom, we wanted 600 by 600 tiles. They wouldn't allow us to do that. So we had to do 300 by 600. So basically, just because of it's difficult with drainage and blah, 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 blah. So with a custom builder, I don't think we would have had those issues, but you're paying a premium for having that available to you. And, the, you know, having, like, we did speak to a custom builder, and it was going to be more than our current budget for that, for our current house, for a house that was more basic than the house we're going for, if that makes sense. It's kind of like buying, going to a little supermarket and buying fewer things that are organic for say $50, and then you go to Coles and you can buy a million different things for $50, but they're not organic, but it's still the same thing, just different kind of quality, I guess that makes sense. But the builder we've chosen, I have a good reputation for quality, and I've researched it extensively, and I'm part of a Facebook group called Shonky Builders that complain about bad builders, and I've never seen any posts about them. And I don't know, so we're hoping that it's going to be fine. I'm pretty confident that it will be, but it just means that the base price of the house was lower, so we were able to do these little extra things like the more expensive kitchen and new, nicer floorboards. And of course, Reese is laying the floorboards and the carpet, so we can spend a little bit more money on the actual product itself, because we don't have to pay for the laying and the labor. And we're collaborating with a couple of brands on things like fixtures and taps, so we don't have to pay outright for those, but we're sharing them on our pages and giving them exposure. That's something that we're super incredibly grateful to be able to do, like unbelievably grateful, because that is, but then in the same breath, it's a really great opportunity for the brand, because so many people are really engaged in this process already, so you're getting your product out there to lots of people that are very keen or are also building themselves. So yeah, that's why this whole process, I'm just being very blatantly honest with you, because we're all grown-ups here and it's just the reality of the situation. Spending a bit more on certain things, saving money on other things, and then we saved money on get project builder rather than having the, you know, fancy custom builder. One day maybe we will, but just wasn't in our budget this time around. So yeah, we are definitely in a unique position that we're very much aware of being in, like really, really cool. But then we've also got certain things like, you know, Reese being able to do things for free, like he can do the decking so long as it complies with the building code. We're just being as savvy as we can possibly be, and I'm really actually, I don't know if people will believe this, but I'm not good at accepting things for free, and I'm very uncomfortable about pimping myself out in terms of reaching out to a brand and being like, I've got this many followers, want to give me some stuff for free? That just goes fundamentally against the kind of person that I am. Makes me very, that's why I'm glad I have my management, because I find it very, very, very uncomfortable. But whenever I tell my management that, they're like, are you kidding me? Like, of course you should, you know, use your position to do things that everybody else would do in your position. Like, why would you pay for something when the brand is offering to give it to you for free if you just say that you've used them publicly? Like, it's a really, really special situation, but it does make me extremely uncomfortable. But I think it's the whole self-doubt thing. I've got to remind myself that it's not just me that's taking, it's also me that's giving to these brands that are getting such a great thing in return. I don't know if people will believe that. You don't have to believe it if you don't want to, but it's the truth. This is the Mecca single shadow in You Know It. I have not used this yet. So yeah, we're not sure when we're going to be moving in to this place, the new place. Oh, that's so strange. It's like the same color as my eyelid, just shimmery. That's so weird. Like, it hasn't really, I thought it was much darker than that. It's very nice though. I'm not mad about it. Because we are like exponentially, unbelievably, undeniably grateful for being able to rent this place. I'm not going to go through the whole story again. If you've heard the whole story of this place and our situation, then you get it. I've done a podcast episode on it. It's called So My Life Has Been a Bit of a Mess This Year, if you're interested in why. But yeah, so incredibly indebted to the owner of this house for allowing us to stay here when her plans were to have it as an Airbnb. Like, so eternally grateful. But in the same breath, it doesn't really feel like home for us, because obviously it's not our home. And it just, I was saying to Reese the other day, when we were waiting for our house to sell, it felt like we were in limbo, because we wanted to move down here, but we couldn't do anything, couldn't rent anywhere. And at this point, all the rentals were getting snatched up because, well, I just put way too much in the corner, because everyone was wanting to move down here. When we first started thinking about moving down, there were like 30 rentals all available at the same time for reasonable prices. And then as soon as we were actually able to move down, there was nothing. It was shocking. Like, the timing was crazy. And then this place just popped up, which was perfect. God, it was just incredible the way it worked out. And so now it kind of feels again like we're in limbo, because we're in this great place and we're so, again, so totally grateful. But, you know, we are really waiting to be in this new place. But then, in that same breath, I was just talking to Reese, in that same breath, it's like, I of all people preach about living in the moment and not wishing away your current reality for the promise of, potential promise of a better future reality, or a better, basically just not wishing away the present moment, because it literally is all you have. And there's no guarantee that the future is going to be any better. Like, you really just got to be so grateful for everything as it's happening. It's just so easy to ignore all of the good things you have in your life right at this very moment, because you're too focused on what is coming and what's ahead. And I don't like doing that. I think it's very unhealthy. I like being present in the moment. And so every time I catch myself doing that, I've got to remind myself, like, nope, this is as good as life is going to get right at this very moment, because this is all I have. And it just reminds me to stop and, like, you know, look around me and see that, oh, you know, this house has got beautiful birds around it, and it's quiet, it's peaceful, and it's close to town, and it's close to the beach, and it's close to this and close to that. So it's like, it's very easy to get caught up in that mindset of always wanting to be doing the next thing and wishing your life away in the hopes that the future's going to be better than the present, but the present's not even bad, and you don't know what the future's going to be like. You know what I'm saying? I feel like I want to tell you guys, because you're the ones that are still watching. I may or may not be releasing a product very soon, and the launch, I don't know what, I'm torn between the me as a person, Lauren, and the YouTuber Lauren Curtis influencer thing that I've always got to keep in mind. The older I get, the more I push away from that version, and the more I'm pushing towards my just me. I know when you launch something, you're meant to do this big campaign, you're meant to get a videographer and all these models and do this big hullabalooza thing and make a big song and dance about it. I think because I've seen so many people do it, I have no desire in my soul to do that. And I'm thinking, the launch, I kind of want to do it like a whole different way. I haven't seen anyone do it this way before. Launch it in a way that rewards my followers, my most loyal followers. So for example, the website and everything will be live, everything's ready to go, but I'm not going to have one specific launch day where I'm like, at 12 p.m., it's live. I want to drop little breadcrumbs. I'm not interested in, like, overnight selling out. I think those days are gone. I get that it, like, creates hype and the whole scarcity thing. You sell more and it creates a thing for the brand, but I'm kind of, I don't know, I just think that's kind of old-fashioned, I don't know, it's just been done, it's exhausting, and people get frustrated. And I want my most loyal followers to be able to get onto the thing and, like, be a part of it first, if they choose to, of course, no pressure either way. But I just don't want that to be this like race or I don't know, and selling out is a massive compliment and great if it happens, don't care if it doesn't happen. I just want it, the people that want it to be able to get it and to have a good experience with it. I'm not, my goal is to have fewer customers that love it more rather than lots of customers who don't like it as much. I want it to be like a little community of people like we have on here, of less people but like awesome people that are really engaged and like-minded and just like, I just love that. It fills my soul and it makes me happier than I've ever been. Just having this like a quality over quantity, that's the one, quality over quantity. So I'm thinking with this launch to, sorry I'm not doing my makeup, but it's hard for me to do both at once. I'm thinking of like now, next video, I'll just say like halfway through the video and like maybe even earlier than that, I don't know, but the ones that are still watching, like the most loyal, the most engaged, the ones that I have to like thank for so much, to say this is the product, I'm only, you are the first to know, no one else knows, everything's there and it's just like a soft launch, everything's ready to go, but this is the product, if you're interested in buying it, here's where you can buy it, you're the first people to get it, and then do that on YouTube first. And then go to like my podcast and do another little hint Instagram stories and share it there. And then the last place, which would usually be the first place you would share something, just post it on Instagram feed and say, this is the product, whee! And say that like I've given access to everyone else on all my other platforms first. And then I can go to TikTok or whatever and then just a normal brand launch. But I just don't. Something in my gut is just like, just don't just overstress yourself with the whole launch thing. I just want the product to speak for itself. I'm really, really happy with it. I hope you guys really like it. It's been years and years and years in the making now, so it's kind of surreal to have it ready to go. Most of you have kind of already assumed what it is. And I'm really looking forward to being able to talk about it more in depth and all that kind of stuff. And it's literally like a month away probably. Maybe 2 months, but I'm assuming it's gonna be a month away. I know the chances of it selling would be probably higher if I do the whole traditional launch thing, but I don't know. I just wanna say thank you to the people that have supported me for so long, and it's not like the thing that I'm bringing out is like the cure for cancer or something. If you are interested, then I just think it's a nice thing to be able to do for the people that have been here supporting me for so long, because you're the reason why I'm able to bring this product out and have the means to be able to produce it. Anyway, that was me rambling. I've got no saliva left. This video is going to be like 10 minutes long. 10 minutes long, 10 hours long. On a whole different topic, I have sold my soul, not really, but it feels like I have, to Stardew Valley. I thought Animal Crossing was addictive. Stardew Valley is next level. And it's funny because I haven't played Animal Crossing in yonks, so long, but I opened it up on my Switch and started playing it just out of curiosity because I'm so used to Stardew Valley graphics and how it's, you know, like pixel art basically, and it's all really like, yeah, it's just nothing compared to Animal Crossing, but I haven't played Animal Crossing in so long that I forgot how good Animal Crossing was. So I started it and I was like, holy crap, I forgot how amazing the graphics were because you're so used to seeing just pixels. but and it's so funny, I'd like forgotten all the controls, I forgot what to do, and I thought, gosh, if the developers of Animal Crossing can incorporate all of the challenges and all of the quests and all of the different things that Stardew Valley has, what that would be like unstoppable. And I actually think that it's nice that you can't, that it's not, I mean, there are multiplayer options in Stardew Valley, but I kind of like that I can't get stuff for free from other, because with Animal Crossing, you know, people can give you things and it kind of, it helps you along your way, but it also kills a bit of the whole point of the game, which is to spend time collecting, and it's very easy to give in to that a bit, that option, and I did numerous times. And I also don't like how Animal Crossing is like real time, in terms of time seems to just move so damn slowly and you always have to time travel to get things done, whereas Stardew Valley moves a little bit too fast sometimes. It's just such a good game. I finally finished the community center, got married to Harvey, had a baby. It was really creepy the way Harvey said to me, he's like, don't you know, my dear, you're pregnant. I was like, oh, this is such a weird thing. So weird. So weird. So that is my mascara done. Why is my face so overexposed? There we go. Wink, wink. But if you haven't played the game and you're wanting something to do in lockdown or isolation, definitely give it a shot. It's available on like every single platform. Can anyone else tell when their eyelashes are going through the different phases? Oh, what are the names? I can't remember. There's like three different stages. One of the stages is like the growth stage. One of the stages is where it's just like dormant, and the other stage is where they fall out. I feel like when I used to wear mascara on my bottom lashes, I didn't ever do this. There's something about pulling out my lashes or touching my eyelashes when I'm wearing mascara goes against everything I believe in. But when I'm not having, when I don't have mascara on and I touch my, like, especially my lower lashes, and it feels like a little sharp feeling where like it needs to be pulled out or it's about to fall out, and I can't help but wait, I can't help but try and pull it out. So then I end up getting little bare patches, especially around these end bits here. I never get it here, but always this end bit. So I often get little bare patches like here and here. And you can kind of see, I don't know if you can see, it's kind of grown back. I had a few little bare patches here and kind of on that side as well. I don't know what the point of me sharing that was. It's the Mecca Max pencil pout in Fancy. It's funny, I don't really get any very many makeup PR parcels anymore because I have removed myself from so many of the PR lists because I'm just getting, it's just, yeah, I was just getting too much and I didn't like the waste considering I don't really use it. So I was wanting the brands to send it to like up and coming creators who would actually get use out of it and can promote the brand for the brand. Oh man, I'm talking so much that I'm getting a sore throat. My Urban Decay one is a lot more purpley. Yeah, that's not gonna do it for me, I don't think. Naked 2 Urban Decay. I don't even know if it's purpley. I think it's just a bit more nude. Old Faithful Tarte Bare Bud lipstick. Yeah, I really need to wash my hair. I can't even let it go. Yeah, anyway, it's fine. You can probably get away with having greasy hair when it's short because it looks like you just slicked it down, but when you've got long hair and it's greasy, then it's all fluffy at the ends and like slicked at the top. Anyway, well, I believe that concludes today's video. I have a feeling it's going to be like 2 hours long, but you know what I've started doing? There's a streamer that I follow now called Katikaris, Jim Caddick. He is British and he streams video games. And what I found myself doing is I first found him from watching a Crash Bandicoot 4 game review. And I really liked his style. And then I watched his other Crash Bandicoot reviews and like PlayStation reviews. So it was just really cool, well thought out videos, very like entertaining. And then I saw that he had a YouTube channel where he streams and plays video games called Caddy Plays. And so I was like, oh, cool. And then I saw that he's been, yeah, streaming, playing Crash Bandicoot, like the old school original games on the old school, like PS1 and PS2. So I've just been loving watching it. It just makes me feel like, this is a really weird way to describe it, but like safe and comfortable because it makes me nostalgic. It fulfills that nostalgic part of me, and I just feel like I made this little routine where I put his videos on and watch him play Crash Bandicoot, which brings up all these good memories, and he's really funny himself, and I eat my little vegetable soup. So just, I think I'm a stickler for like routines, and I feel really safe when I've got a routine that I like. And so I've been really enjoying doing that, and now I've just started watching his other streams where he's playing other games because I just really enjoy watching him. So I think and I will watch his videos while I'm either like playing my game or I'm just watching him or I'm eating, kind of in the background. Is just in a similar way that I watch horror movies, which is really strange. It's very comforting to me, which I know is kind of backwards horror movies, but I feel like it must be making me feel cozy and safe in my, like, you know, little house while something scary going on outside. I don't know what it is. It is a little bit disturbing probably, but just like I am. So So same thing with his videos, I get that kind of feeling. So I'm hoping that people get that same thing from my videos, where I'm just, you know, talking through life and doing my makeup, and you don't necessarily have to be watching me do it, but just have it on in the background or something. So maybe the length doesn't really matter. I hope you don't mind anyway. And if you do mind, you don't have to watch it anyway. So it's there for those who want it, and if not, that's fine. Anyway, thank you so much for watching, you guys. I really, really, really appreciate it, especially if you've watched this far. That's really, really, really cool. Yeah, very, very much appreciated. This is like, you're my favorite of all the people, because you're sticking around for the whole thing. So thank you so much. Not that I have favorites, but I guess I'm most grateful to those of you who are still here. Anyway, I'm rambling. Thank you so much. Have an amazing week, and I'm sure I will speak to you all very soon. Bye, guys.